Hello. Welcome. My name is Acrillus, and we're doing a replay casting of the ESL and Katowice semifinals. This is Game 2 versus Team Secret and Gambit Esports. Team Secret stomped Gambit in Game 1. It was very sad, and I hope to see a lifestealer ban in the first three bans of Gambit Esports, or we'll see another loss. So let's get down to it. So, what do you know about Team Secret? You know their Puppy is great. Puppy is awesome. He's a great shot caller. Yeah. So Team Secret's style will be very, very cutthroat. So it'll be very clean, but it'll be very aggressive in times. So you'll see a lot of decisions that come from the Secret players will coordinate very well sometimes, but without Puppy, it might also be very hard to coordinate a lot of times too. But I don't know. I think a lot of the Secret players are pretty self-sufficient. 5 seconds remaining. In terms of bans, Lifesteal has been really strong lately. A lot of supports are really strong. They did make a first pick Chen ban. It's probably just because Chen has such good early game pressure with the capture. They banned Lashrak again from mid one. That's really weird. Gambit committed Chen PA. Gambit committed way too many resources by banning out. They banned the first three bans they made, which was their pretty much like their entire ban phase for like the first half of the draft was all mid picks. They banned Lashrak, Kunkka, and I think Viper. So they banned out mid one entirely, and Secret literally just first pick Lifestealer and the game ended. So hopefully we'll see that not happen again. A bounty hunter ban again, so Secret really don't have to make it should be, but Secret really don't have to make any concessions to what they did last game, so they're making the same bans. So Chen and the Bounty Hunter ban are really just for early game presence. And I guess Gambit either have been really successful with it in the rest of the tournament, but who knows. Yeah, Secret have definitely done their research, so these bans are definitely justified. In all sense, though I can make of it, is the early game presence. Gambit are repeating their mistakes with the Kunkka ban again. I mean, obviously, Kunkka's a great choice to ban, especially against mid one. He's probably one of the better mid laners in the world. There's a lifesteal ban. Okay, so they instead not to ban Viper out. So you might see Viper pick here, which is going to be really good against like most of the mid lane picks you could do right now. Monkey King, Lashrak was a good one. I've seen Monkey King be like a decent hard count or like a decent counter to like most of the mid laners right now. But they're probably going to pick something different, like their position 5. I'm going to anticipate last game they played Brewmaster together with Lion, but the Lion was a last pick. What do they prioritize? The Caudle? Yeah, the Caudle was nasty last game. The Will-O-Wisp pretty much made it so that every engage Gambit made was denied. Like, the moment that Gambit committed to a fight, they could get maybe like one pick, but then like the rest of Secret's team fighting ulti shut them down. So hopefully Gambit either come through with a silencer here or something very disruptive. Because the strategy of early game pressure definitely didn't work out. Mostly just because Gambit didn't force them into late game picks, you know? Gambit really picked really a strong early game comp, but Team Secret picked the Lifestealer first, and then they just realized what Gambit were doing and just picked against that, you know? They picked a really good disengage comp. They had Brewmaster, Primal Split, Caudle, Will-O-Wisp. They also had the Lion Finger for return kill really fast so that he could disengage very easily. It was really nuts, honestly. And with the Lifestealer at the end of the game, they kind of just rolled over everything. Hopefully that doesn't happen again, but we'll see. 10 seconds left. I have shorts under here. The same pick again with the Nyx Assassin and the Visage. So they're going the same strat again, except without the Lifestealer. So they're basically, I think Gambit's viewpoint on this game right now is, okay, the Lifestealer was a very bad mistake by us, but now that he doesn't have it, our strategy should work out a lot better than before. So you're going to see, in all likelihood, the same thing they did last game. They took the safe lane, and they made it a tri-lane against the enemy safe lane. So they parked both the Visage, the Nyx Assassin, and the Lich in the bottom lane. The Pango pick is the same as last time. Surprisingly enough, they put in mid one Pango, which was really funny. Gambit bans Lycan, obviously. That's just another great meta hard carry, especially since split push has been a very, very popular strategy in a lot of these games. The Underlord is banned, obviously, because it's a really strong offlaner. It's probably one of the strongest offlaners. Especially if you're going offlaner against offlaner, Underlord can pretty much just clear every single wave. So, and then pretty much cover, clear every single wave, deny your last hits, and then go take jungle camps. Yeah. So the Pango pick is up in the air in terms of like what it could be. It could be mid one Pango again, or in all likelihood, it's probably going to be like Zai Pango. I've seen position 5 Pangos too. I saw Kuroki play Pango and Liquid on the MDL Macau game, so in the finals. Or no, it wasn't the finals. I think it was another one of the games, but it was interesting. I mean, obviously it has its merits as a very good disruption tool, especially against things like familiars who aren't who aren't immune to it, by the way. But the Visage is definitely their safe lane pick. In all honesty, the Visage pick is, in most cases, going to be a safe lane or a mid pick. I think they're going to use it to pressure the safe lane carry, because that's the same strategy they took last game, but also because now there's no Lifestealer. So you can't really get denied from like all your damage and follow-up that Visage has by just clicking Rage, you know? Like, obviously, Puppy's going to be there again, so he's going to, like, use Illuminate to harass and kind of just keep Gambit at bay, but that in turn also pushes the wave in. Brewmaster Bank comes in, so they don't want Zai to pick up Brewmaster. Okay, yeah, so Gambit has pretty much figured out at this point that Secret are trying to adopt the same strategy, but with a different hard carry, something probably like a PA or a Troll, something that will last a good amount of time in the fight. So they banned out the Brewmaster so that they have less potential for disruption in team fights, which is definitely good. I mean, Gambit really needed something to carry them with more momentum, so they're probably going to pick something that has a good amount of CC or team fighting value here, I think, before they lock down something else. I think it's going to be position 3. Position 3 and position 5. Because I think the Nyx is position 4 and the Visage is position probably 2 or 1. A Rubick is definitely really strong. They banned it out last ban phase. This is a really good time to pick a Rubick, I think. Radiant team's turn to pick. The Jakiro comes out. Jakiro is a very aggressive early game setup. Dual Breath is probably one of the best abilities in the game because it both slows and applies damage over time, as well as just an attack speed slow. So really, if you hit a Dual Breath during a fight at like level 1, you're going to lose that fight. So this is their tri-lane setup right now. 10 seconds remaining. Oh yeah, that's right. They let Jug through the draft too. Oh no. Since Gambit have pretty much showed their entire safe lane setup, Secret are free to pick whatever they need, and Rubick is a really good disengage. Oh man, that's a good pick, especially on Yaps, where he's probably one of the best Rubick players in the world. No. It sucks, especially when you're Gambit, who like does well at local and regional tournaments, and they show up sometimes at like some international minors, and they place like, you know, top 8 or something at some majors. So they still have a showing every now and then. 5 seconds remaining. Their pick here is definitely going to be the hard carry. They have to prioritize mid pick as last. No, it's going to be position 3, because the Visage is the Visage has to be the hard carry. Although Gambit could figure out that they left Jug open and decide, oh, we fucked up. So it might just... But it's going to be so hard to play the Visage anywhere else, because the Visage is so reliant on Snowball. Yep, they pick a Night Stalker. That's going to be position 3. They pretty much realized with the Brewmaster ban that their position 3 in lane is either going to have to be Pango, and since they picked the Rubick, it has to be Pango, since Puppy's going to be position 5, Yapzor is obviously position 4, so the Pango's position 3, the Viper is mid, so they're saving their safe lane pick at the end, which is odd because they're going to ban Jug out now on Gambit. There's the S Shadow Fiend ban on Secret too that we didn't mention as well. Secret, I guess we're a little concerned with a stronger mid pick, and mid one was also probably concerned about it too, considering all the things that he has had banned out from him. Lushrak and Kunkka are both very excellent Shadow Fiend counters, by the way. So now that they've picked the Viper, Gambit have the freedom to make their safe lane ban and then their mid pick. whereas Secret will have to make
Canadian
their
teams
safe
can be
carry
banned.
pick and their mid ban. The PA is banned, not a good choice. I mean, the PA is one of the carries that can escape your aggression by getting blink strike off to their allies. It doesn't happen every time, and there's a guy that's probably a lot more concerning to your team comp too, and it's
Banning
Jug.
someone CC. 10 seconds remaining.
Gambit have a lot of CC, but
Five
Blink
seconds
Strike is pretty
remaining.
broken
Team's turn
together
has
with
been
Illuminate,
sandpicked.
'cause basically what the coordination
Oh,
control
there.
warlord. Okay, cool. So Secret have valued the DPS over the magic community in this situation. Do they know that they're
Once they
gonna?
survive.
They have. Team Secret have to assume that Gambit are gonna try the same thing again and put the safe lanes against each other. So you're gonna have. So either their plan is to put Yapzor together with Puppy
10
and try
seconds
to
remaining.
work it like that, because Nightstalker doesn't have much presence in their off lane, so
5 seconds
off lane's pretty much
remaining.
just gonna be a free lane either way, unless
Try
they.
some nights.
Well, it depends on if they tri lane or not. If they tri lane, off lane is. Gambit's off lane is free if they tri lane. If they don't tri lane, it is decent pressure, but not as much as Pango versus Rubick, you know? Or Pango with Rubick. Like, Pango and Rubick have a lot more base damage than Nyx and Nightstalker are gonna have. No, Nyx is always going to be position 4. Nightstalker will always be the position 3 because he has to get that level 6 fast so that he can be a stronger presence. Nyx is, you're going to be using the Impale most of the time early game, as well as Spiked Carapace to kind of just catch them out. So, I mean, my anticipation for this game is that they're going to play until Nisha and
Choose your
mid 1
hero.
need to get all the resources. Oh, an OD pick mid. Okay. Okay, so with the range on OD, they're not going to be a threat to mid at all unless they coordinate a gank. But yeah, it's about as expected. Zai will go off lane with the Pango. Afterlife will go off lane with the Night Stalker. FNG and Immersion on the same as before. Yapzor on his signature Rubick. Puppy on the Caudle, same last game. The difference here will be the Jhaqyro to see whether or not it executes better as the position 5. And if it's enough to stop Yapzor, who is probably the most insane Rubick player ever. Who knows? We'll see how things pan out. But yeah. Hopefully this game gets started momentarily. Other than that, let's see. How's the laning phase gonna go? So if they do commit to the tri lane, Nisha and Puppy are probably gonna ha Nisha's gonna definitely gonna have to play super safe and maintain ranged form. Puppy's probably just gonna illuminate a lot of the waves so that Nisha can garner XP. They're gonna be using Whirling Axes to clear a lot of jungle camps. Gambit's strategy is gonna be denying as much experience to Nisha as possible, as well as pressuring mid. But I don't know how well they can pressure mid. I'm not sure. I'm not really familiar with the matchup between Viper and OD. You know, that's not a matchup you see every day, except in like Dota Pros. But we'll see how things pan out. Nice. There. So I get Yapzor walking up mid with boots and tangos and a ward, so he's probably gonna get that ward off. What else is there? Zai, standard start, couple mangoes, tangos, stout shield. Nisha obviously has that 6 tangos, maintain presence. Puppy gave away his 2 tangos to mid one. He's going for that double. Oh, okay, so he's going for the double. He's going for double Wraith Band. As opposed to what I've seen in a couple matches, especially in the MDL Macau tournament. I saw a lot of mid lane Viper with Atos instead of just like the regular right click, you know, like things like Hurricane Pike, Force Staff. Regular deep range DPS items.
30
Both
seconds to
teams have
cabin.
established a ward mid. Gambit looks to be positioning their safe lane in the traditional spot. Okay, so they've played Secret here a little bit. Secret, we're kind of assuming they're gonna go the same way and have that. Oh yeah, so they're gonna have their tri lane back against their safe lane. So we'll play a little bit better with Puppy and stuff, but instead Gambit opt to play the traditional setup with the tri lane against the Sai. So okay, Yapzor's positioned on the flank here, so he's gonna try and
Snowball
secure the other
fight.
bounty rune. And he does so successfully. Not really much of a punish other than the Grave Chill that comes out. Yapstar's going the other way, though, towards the Shrine, so he's going to get collapsed on by the mid laner here. The mid laner decides not to block, but no, they can't catch him. The Grave Chill is too short, and he has boots, so he's going to get out scot-free. FNG will chase him a little bit to make sure he stays out of the jungle so that he can't block the creep wave. Immersion rotates back bottom because he knows that Zai is going to be by himself. So, or no, Zai is going to be together with Yapstar, and Afterlife cannot play a solo Night Stalker against a Troll and a Caudle. It's almost impossible. So they're going to need that presence in both lanes. The Grave Chill comes off on Zai as well as the Dual Breath, but the Fade Bolt hits FNG, so reduce right-click damage. Zai commits the Swashbuckle to get that last on the range creep, and that's a pretty good trade overall. Looks like, yeah, these are going to be a lot more of even lanes. Yapstar is going to have an easier time diverting the aggression, but Gambit, I think, got the better of these two because they're playing. As long as Gambit play around Swashbuckle well, they should be able to do a good amount of damage to this offlane here. Meanwhile, the safe lane is going to have a lot better of a time on Secret than the offlane on Gambit. Looks like Immersion is pulling the wave all the way over to tier 3s. Wow, that's crazy. Is he just going to hold it there for the next wave? Ping goes out on an Afterlife. Puppy's just trying to zone him. He got Chakra first. Okay, I see. Because Nisha's gone Whirling Axes first. So they're using Nisha's Whirling Axes to make sure he gets the last hits at tower. And using the Chakra magic to keep it up. Meanwhile, I'm curious to see how this lane's going. Main one's gotten his first Wraith ban, whereas Alpha Ninja hasn't gotten anything yet. The last hits are 7-3 against... Where's OD? 7-2. Okay, so they're pretty much even. Oh, gets an eye off on the range creep. That's good. It's good. The Astral Prison doesn't really get many last hits. Gets pressured by the poison Thanks attack now. Oh, I missed the first blood off on the Zai. Zai gets the first blood against FNG, who is not there? Huh? I have to rewind. I apologize for that. So we go top lane. Zai's getting doped by FNG. Okay, yeah, so Zai dies in return for first blood on FNG. Looks like Immersion rotated for a gank, and Zai really just turned it around with the Fade Bolt, or together with the Swashbuckle and the Fade Bolt. So FNG goes down there. The Hawk was actually pretty low too as well. Yapstar is feeling pretty confident getting his last hits here without any... Spots out Immersion too, so they know he's still here. He's committed TP, so he's kind of just going to be stuck here for now. An Invis rune in the river. Neither mid laner has spotted it yet. But Immersion, Yapstar is on his way, followed by Immersion. Yapstar spots the Invis rune first, manages to grab it. He's got a clarity going on too as well, so he should be able to take advantage of the Invis. Immersion, by the way, just gets spotted by Yapstar. And then one takes the necessary precautions, I think, so it should be fine. But they should know that Immersion hasn't rotated back yet. Yep, Yapstar spots him out with the vision because of his invis. You should have been able to spot him out here. Let's see. Yep, spots out FNG. Immersion thinks he's okay, maybe? No, he definitely knows he's been spotted. The solo lane here at the Night Stalker, yeah, still not going very well. She kinda concede a good amount of farm. So minus 5 last hits to 16 and 5 from Nisha. Overall, the laning phase is going pretty much as you had anticipated it. Mid lane's training, mid one and Afro Ninja. Overall, relatively the same position. It looks like, yeah, mid one is actually electing to go for the crown instead of the second Wraith band. Does that mean he's changing to the Atos build? He might be, actually, yeah. It would be a good choice, especially against the Night Stalker. But it doesn't have much use against the other three because they'll probably buy force. Who knows? It'll be different. Astral Imprisonment goes down and mid one deny him a couple of last hits. He gets the range creep in the process of it too. Mid one really just taking a heavy trade here. Meanwhile, Zai against the Hawk. Obviously going to take a lot of harassment and punishment, but not too much else. Immersion walks up to get some... to eat some damage from Yapstar. Gets a Fade Bolt on him. Immersion walks up with a Spike. Impale though! Hits the Impale! Okay, Zai has the wand now. He's able to get out free. He's able to get out. I don't know why I said free. So funnily enough, FNG didn't try to capitalize on that aggression too. I guess it was just getting that block in. Looks like he'll have to pull it to the second camp. Immersion pings it out, letting him know that the camp is there so he can pull it, but Secret are here to position themselves so they can't pull the wave back. Yeah, so Secret attempt to pull the hard camp over to the mini wave and do so successfully, except for the range creep, which is unfortunate, but happens. Mid one now, transferring. Yep, so he's starting to max nether toxin. He's realized, mid one, despite getting the Wraith Band first, is now trying to transition to Atos instead of just general right click. I guess the Wraith Band was just to enable him to last hit in lane, which is a good decision. Afterlife notices the block, or the pull by Puppy, tries to get as many last hits as he can, and in turn also tries to pull the minion wave back towards the rest of his minion wave, but doesn't manage to block it in time, so he'll get a little bit of XP from these, and a little bit of gold. Guess there's an eye off on that creep. Mid one with the kill on Immersion. Looks like Immersion came in for the gank, but got cut off by Yapsor, so I missed that one again. Fuck. I should be looking more at the map. TP comes in for Immersion, he's back down in the off lane. Whereas mid one, he's got enough levels in Nether Toxin now that he can kind of just put it down, shove the wave, and now he's going to go take some jungle camps probably. Yep, taking notes from our good friend Mitoma Man. Oh, Impale goes down on a Puppy. Puppy looks like he's trouble. Blinding Light gets him out of there. Spike Carapace does not activate enough to stun him. It is nighttime, so Night Stalker does have a statistical advantage now. Not over him, but... Oh, the Impale goes down on Anisha. Guarantees that Immersion gets a couple last hits and a deny, and he's good to go back into lane. Meanwhile, mid one, managed to grab a double damage, and is still back to farming these camps. Top lane, looking pretty okay. Zai takes a good chunk of damage, but he's trying to heal up. He's already got his javelin. He's opted to go for that instead of the boots first or the bottle. Concerning all the fighting they've done, it is reasonable to assume that that is the better choice. Gets a swashbuckle off, takes down a good amount of layers on the... Oh no, didn't take any layers off on the Grave Cloak, actually. Just one. Dual Breath goes down, doesn't get enough damage. Yapsor tries to harass FNG. FNG is really low now without any regen, so he's going to have to play passive for a little bit or choose to Shrine. Afro Ninja pretty much doing the same thing as mid one, trying to capture as many jungle camps as he can before the wave hits his tower, but obviously mid one is going to have the advantage of that since Nether Toxin will push a little faster. He still does have Astral Prison though, so he does have a good amount, like a decent amount of counter push. More so than he would have had last game. As the Razor. Nisha is just pressuring Afterlife under his tower. Immersion has rotated top, so Nisha has to know that Immersion's not here. They have to know. In order for him to play that far up on the tower. Yep, and they have. Yep, Zai's teleported back up. They're all together. Immersion gets spotted. Yapsor lifts him, fades bolt him immediately. Puppy does nothing to follow up. The spike carapace is ready. He uses it to ensure that he escapes safely. Meanwhile, the Vox is trying to get these last hits off the wave that Secret has pulled towards the hard camp. Hopefully they can get the centaur here, but they're pinging him out. So they want to stop this from happening. So they deny the last hit, but they don't get the gold for it either. They just get the XP. Swashbuckle comes out onto Immersion. He decides not to impale his eye. While FNG has roamed towards mid in order to ensure FNG's safety. Mid one, still doing those jungle camps. Nisha, still pulling camps. Overall, looks pretty quiet compared to last game. The ice path comes down to deny any follow-up onto the ward, and the ward gets killed by FNG, and Impale goes down as well as a dual breath. Chunk side down to about 60% HP, but he's still doing alright. Same old, pulling those camps back into the hard camp. It's really good timing by Secret here. Nisha goes on for the solo kill onto Afterlife. Probably just got a lucky root together with this phase boots and the whirling axes. Oh, damn. Yeah, I'm gonna have to keep... So, lessons for a beginner caster. I'm gonna have to take note of the health bars on the top a lot more. And I'm looking at the minimap as much as I can. Nisha is going for Battle Fury. So he's playing the long game here. He knows that OD is probably gonna outscale him if he doesn't get enough farm. So he's gonna have to push for that Battle Fury. Yeah, the ops, yeah, looks like yeah. Dahak is pretty much opting for the same build as last game. Medallion, adopting the same strategy as last game also, as well as taking the ancient camps. A little unfortunate that 7.21 I think the patch was that removed the ancient camps on the top side where the usual safe lane should be. It's a little unfortunate, but it allows them to get those camps a little earlier into the game, which benefits the mid laners, especially mid ones Viper here. It's funny enough, the Nether Toxin disables the magic resistance, right? Yeah, it does. Yeah, so he can clear that wave out without as much issues. Oh, ulti goes down on Anisha. Anisha has Battle Trance ready. He's ready to activate it, though. Nice talk about the ulti, but the Soul Assumption. It just takes down Anisha. He doesn't decide to activate his Battle Trance. And Yapsor is in trouble now. Does the telekinesis on Afterlife. Afterlife getting low due to the tower, but the Impel goes down onto Yapsor, and he gets killed by the Familiars, and the Hawk grabs the double kill. A very weird mistake by Secret. Probably the same thing as last time when I told you guys about how things might be a little different when Puppy's not present there. But Puppy's choosing to rotate now, TP's to the tier 2 tower, while Zai TP's to the bottom tier 1 tower. Looks like they decided to rotate the lanes out now. Anisha said, guys, I could probably get more farm over here against FNG. And the Hawk has rotated bottom as well, so this is a good timing for Secret to kind of just make that rotation. The bounty rune is still up. Anisha should have seen it and should have grabbed it. I mean, he will do so now, so no harm, no foul. Afterlife here at bottom still. Since the Hawk is positioned around the Ancients, okay, I see. Okay, so Gambit has basically made the choice that since the Hawk is going to farm Ancients, he's also going to have time to rotate over in case they decide to fight. And Secret haven't seen that coming for some reason, since they didn't know where the Hawk was earlier. You should have known that he was farming camps though in the jungle. Maybe they anticipated him being towards the top of the map since he was the safe lane. They probably thought he did something different, but he's got the same old strat. Immersion gets Vendetta. Looks like most of our friendly faces will have their ulties now. Most of them committed in the last fight to kill Anisha on Gambit, so Secret do have the advantage right now if they do decide to have a team fight. Immersion does spot Troll Warlord, so he's getting a good amount of information and tracking on him. Looks for the courier but doesn't grab it. Looks like, yeah, FNG does mark the mid lane, so he does notice that mid one is still there. So looks like Yapsor is rotating over to ensure mid one's safety, while Immersion kind of just sits in between trying to look for the courier snipe. Yeah, the rest of Secret are sitting around by the river. Puppy together with Zyre positioned around the bottom lane. Afro Ninja cops a double damage rune from the top side of the river, however. And the Hawk continuing to farm, as well as Anisha. Anisha, I'd probably say, let's check out the net worth, actually. So, Anisha, yep, is definitely leading this game. She's probably gotten the most free farm so far. Mid one following close behind, about 400 gold away. Obviously, taking camps with another toxin is going to be a little more, a little less efficient, but still could get enough job. Afro Ninja with the Astral Prison will keep up in speed. Really not too much contention in the mid lane. Both of them are really getting their gold in, just focusing on getting their first power spike with their level 6. Next one followed by Zai. Zai gets the kill onto Immersion, who slips up again and decides to walk up onto a sentry ward. Another toxin comes down along with the poison touch, does some damage. The Viper Strike comes in on FNG as well as the Swashbuckle, putting him down very low. The Liquid Fire's, the Macro Fire's committed, but another toxin as well, the Autos from Zai will lock it down. It's a good Micro Fire, does damage on the wave, so it makes it so they can't push as much. Afterlife is positioned together with his ulti, ready for a team fight. Looks like Immersion is TPing back, as well as the Hawk is positioning himself by the Ancient Camp. Secret won't be able to spot this out. They don't have the wards. Does steal Impale. Looks like he's going to get another Impale. Nether Toxin disables him. Oh! Night Stalker activates Dark Ascension, but he's already dead on the Nether Toxin. Oh, he's too low. Yeah, the passive is disabled by the Hunter in the Night by the Nether Toxin. A mistake walking into that, but he also does get chunked down low by the Poison Touch and the Nether Toxin, as well as the Swashbuckle. Another Toxin comes down to clear the next wave, and it looks like Secret have pretty much established, hey, we're stronger than you, we're gonna get this tower now. Gambit, while trying twice, have been like, oh, okay, yeah, I guess you are. FNG still here, for some reason, looking to just, yep, Macro Pyre and clear the wave. Yeah, it's a good decision, but you're not gonna be able to do it to deny the tower. Yeah, they're gonna get the tower. So the first tower down for Secret. Good amount of advantage here. The 4k lead with two kills up on Secret. Immersion decides to pop Vendetta to get more information. Rolling Thunder is being, oh, it's being casted, but it gets canceled out. They do spot the Sentry Ward. They are warding out, looking for Immersion. And Immersion is actually sneaking up on Nisha here, keeping an eye on him. They do spot him out, so they do know that he is working towards that Battle Fury. Puppy doing what he does. Now that all his carries are pretty much done needing that babysitting, he's just going to have a TP and try to farm and cover the lanes as much as he can so that his team can benefit off the aggression they can pursue with the space given by Puppy. Looks like Bounty Rune Secret does have the advantage to get 3 to the 1 Bounty Rune. Immersion, his Vendetta ends, so he TP's back mid, but he does get hit by the Atos as well as another Toxin. Does do a good amount of damage, chunks him out to half health with the Swashbuckle. Another Nether Toxin goes down, but he gets Astral Prisoned. Mid one, sitting there, doing nothing. But Yapstor is here as well, helping to cover him up. FNG gets the quick kill on the Puppy together with Afterlife. Yep, they do get the pickoff on that, so they do know what he was doing. A Force Staff on the Alpha Ninja, so he does manage to escape the Nether Toxin Rod of Atos combo, but the Spike Carapace does slip. Does stun down mid one. He gets the ulti off. Oh my god. Immersion dies again. He's too squishy. The Rolling Thunder is casted, but Gambit has already made their move, and they've lost. And they weren't able to take advantage, but mid one was really low, but unfortunately does not get finished off. It's really unfortunate. They committed a lot of things. The Sanity's Eclipse. Actually, they only committed the Sanity's Eclipse. The Sanity's Eclipse was Vendetta. The Rolling Thunder was casted, though, so... Again, Secret don't get away with it scot-free, but it is obviously a disaster considering what happened to Immersion right there. Not the best game he's having, both last game and this game. We do see Puppy doing the same strategy again. FNG is positioning to punish again, though. He does notice that he is casting the Illuminate. Does manage to pick up on it. Casts the Dual Fire. Yep, Macro Pyre goes down to block the trees. The Will-O-Wisp does go down to distract them for a little moment. Oh, the Swashbuckle comes in with the TP from Zai. Silences FNG. Afro Ninja decides, yeah, it's not worth it. He's out. Yep, Secret have, yep. It is a product of what I mentioned earlier. This guy is definitely calling the shots here. He's telling them, hey guys, they're gonna come again. We can punish them here. Now Secret has committed to the rotation mid. It is nighttime though, so Afterlife is gonna have that Hunter in the Night active, but a lot of members of Gambit are very low. Afro Ninja and Immersion are both low. Immersion, you have died several times while still in stealth. You should not be there. But he's still getting the information play. Looks like, Yep, Nisha has picked up his Battle Fury and he's now working towards a Saint Jin Yasha and a BKB. Looks like Yaria does have that. Yasha walks up, gets hit by the Vendetta. The Ice Path blocking the advance from the rest of the team. He does pluck. Oh, Hunter in the Night comes down with the Silence. Night Stalker trying to push on to Nisha, but Nisha still has Battle Trances, still fine. Immersion, yet again, the one to be punished this time. It is Dark Ascension. That is the spell. My apologies. It was not Hunter in the Night. He activates Dark Ascension. Initiate onto the Troll Warlord. Meanwhile, Puppy zoning with the Illuminate. The Hawk here split pushing with the rest of his familiars. And Afro Ninja pushing up on that while they maintain pressure up here. Looks like Secret isn't committing to this. They're deciding instead to rotate and cover the lanes. But no one has rotated bottom yet. Zai is here in order to pressure Afro Ninja, but Gambit are here to punish. The Invis here from Afterlife tries to get the Silence off with the Swashbuckle, but it's not enough. Tries also to get the Spike Carapace on the Swashbuckle, but that also doesn't activate as well. Secret, things are looking really good for Secret here. They do manage to get the Vision Control over mid lane, so they spot out that the ward was there. Obviously, if Gambit had made a move on that, they would have known that no one else was behind Zai other than a couple supports, which is manageable enough if they try to kill him. Immersion now really needs to go for some farm. He's really far down on the net worth ladder, as well as FNG. Both of Secret's supports are able to push out and collect waves. Oh, yeah, Immersion gets caught out while trying to farm. The Swashbuckle comes down with the Atos and the Telekinesis, and this man is dead. Yapsler manages to steal the Impale before he goes down, so now he has another gauge tool in case Secret want to be more aggressive than they already have been. Afro Ninja decides to position around the bottom side of the lane in order to push bottom. Secret has really not pushed much attention to it, and they've continued to maintain their presence around the top side of the jungle, as well as mid lane. The Hulk has gone back to farming in the jungle. Let's see, any major buys here from any of the carries onto Gambit. Looks like the Helmet Dominator down for the Hawk. You really should diversify your item choice, but still a good amount of items. The Midas down from Afterlife, so he's looking to get a little more. He doesn't really have the items he needs to push himself into a fight and be tanky, so Gambit will really have the issue with that. Meanwhile, Secret calmly getting rushed because they have the vision control. The macro pyre goes down, but he gets A-toast and locked up with the lucky shot into the nether toxin, so FNG will go down immediately. Meanwhile, we do see Afterlife picking up the mid lane wave between the two towers. They're not going to be able to push if you let him do that. The TP comes in. Who's it going to be? Looks like it is. Yep, Sword catching him out. Telekinesis back into his team with the lucky strike. Does silence him down. The Illuminate does finish him off. Gambit, what is going on? It's like there's they've created a team comp in a draft where they're designed to take advantage of the early game and try to outpace Secret, but Secret have just made so much more plays on the map. Just denied that. The Rolling Thunder comes out to deny the Grave Chill. Zai is looking to go back in, misses the Rolling Thunder hit, so he doesn't stun him and instead decides to back off because of that. A lot of sentry wards down mid from Gambit. They have very much cleared out the vision mid, so they are looking to make a play onto Nisha, who's advancing together with mid one and Puppy. Puppy, though, clearing out the vision that they had in the lane itself. The smoke goes off onto FNG. FNG smoke pops. He knows that Puppy is there. The Will-O-Wisp goes down, locks down two members of Gambit, but Aphrodite is down to put the Astral Prison down. Locked down by the Will-O-Wisp. Immersion goes down too. It's an expected casualty, as Gambit really have not been able to make a good play. The blame doesn't really go on to much else other than the communication between the team members. Obviously, things look really bad for Immersion and somewhat Afterlife too as well. And FNG, you know, the position 4 and 5 is really taking the biggest hit here. The telekinesis goes down and another toxin. And Afro Ninja's dead, unable to cast Astral Prison on himself. The macro pyre from the behind, though, gets stolen by Yapsor. Another macro pyre going down from the Rubik. The Dark Ascension active, but he gets rooted in the... Rooted again. There's nothing he has to stop that. Ice Path goes down as Nisha tearing down this mid tier 3. And at this point, there's really not much else that Gambit can do here other than watch the game. And Immersion goes down again. This Atos is really... I understand why you banned it in the first game. I understood it at the beginning and why you banned it in the first game, but was this really a better choice than playing against the Lashrak? I don't know. Yeah, but like as I was saying earlier, Gambit really, the coordination was the biggest problem that they had. Nisha gets stunned by this ice path. Afro Ninja TPs into the Lirax and gets stunned instantly. Telekinesis up into the nether toxin and he's dead. Dual Breath coming down. Yeah, Gambit pretty much discovered that this is a GG. They're kind of just throwing themselves in there to try and get kills, but it's not working. Unfortunate, but Team Secret executed this really well. Strategy is really nice. Obviously, a lot of things that weren't expected came out, but that is also due to the part that I believe a lot of the team cohesiveness comes from Puppy's direction. Yeah. It seems like a lot of times when Puppy was not present at the fight, there was a lot less coordination. When Puppy was on the opposite side of the map, Nisha dies under tower. What's up with that? You know, it's the one mistake Secret made that game, but Gambit should have really taken notice of this and should be able to utilize it if they do come up against Secret again. But that is game 2 of the semifinals between Secret and Gambit. Not what we very much expected, but hopefully you guys enjoyed this. If you have any comments or anything you might suggest to help me improve on this cast, please let me know. But other than that, I will see you guys next time.